please welcome, with the greatest possible respect, Lenny McLean.
I'm the governor!
Would love life to be like this, a bed of roses. But unfortunately, it's not. Personally, I like to use my hands to make love. This is a film about people who use their fists to make war.
My name is Lenny McLean. I'm a bare-knuckle fighter. These are my fists in action.
I was, 20 years, known as the hardest man in Britain. I went all around the country fighting the toughest in the country for money. And I was the best in my time. See, when I was a younger man in the East End, to be a street fighter, you gave respect. And I wanted to be the governor, the best street fighter, so that's what happened. If I lived at St. John's Wood, I'd probably been a college professor. But, you know, I come from a brutal area where I didn't want to be kicked, so I kicked first. But that's all in the past now. As I was walking through St. Paul, some lady grabbed me by the hand. I've come to the British Museum to find out more about bare-knuckle fighting, because evidently it goes back thousands of years.
How would you like a right hand up for that?
What I found was there are drawings of fighters from the Minoan fire 6,000 years ago. The Greeks, 3,000 years later, loved it and put fist fighting in their original Olympics. They weren't out to nick bare-knuckle fighters like we do today. They put them on works of art. knuckle fighting has been illegal for more than 100 years. Go to any front door of any nightclub in the country. It still goes on.
Part of the tradition of bare knuckle has been kept by doormen. A lot of bare knuckle fighters are doormen or former doormen. And it's been used universally, bare knuckle fighting has been used universally by doormen to straighten situations out. That's why they call it a bare knuckle fight or a match fight or a square go. They call it a straightener. I'm going to be commentating on some of the bare knuckle fights that you're about to see tonight. The reason I'm commentating is because I've spent most of my adult life dealing with violence and violent people. I have been in that arena. These are big, heavy fighters, and both of them look very capable. Both of them are very fit. Both of them holding a lot of artillery. I think we're going to see a very good fight. It's a nice right again, good right hand. He's really committing his hips properly as well. If you look at his right leg, he's really turning his hip in. Both look pretty experienced, both experienced here, both got good guards, sizing each other up. Yeah, bit of a weak right there, trying to get it through. Back into a clinch again, there's some heavy punches landing both sides. I think the blue fighter caught one on the nose, another one on the nose, that was a heavy shot. Yeah, oh, he's getting that left lock in all the time. Oh, yeah, there he goes, left hand, knocked him to the floor. It really shook him there. Oh, dear me, he's running in. He's taking advantage of the fact that the guy is struggling. The crowd are not going to like that. The referee's giving him a telling off there. The second's giving him a telling off. The crowd are starting to kick off over the side. Look at the guy in the grey t-shirt in the corner there. Here he goes again. Look, he's fighting again. He's jumping from one fight to another. I wouldn't be surprised if we end up seeing him getting pulled out into the middle. If he wants to do it in the crowd, they'll pull him out to do it there. Oh, the boxers have got back into it again. Nobody seems to be noticing them now. They're trading punches. This is not really a technical fight. This is two big guys just matching punch for punch. The crowd seems to be getting upset again. The referee and the second are pushing them out. Oh, they're all fighting. We go back into a clinch again. Makes you realise when you see how many clinches there are, it makes you realise why so many fights outside end up on the floor. They're clinching every few seconds. If there wasn't a referee there, they'd be on the floor already. He's pushing the black fighter up against the wall now. Bit of rabbit punching in the back of the head there. Oh, the referee's caught one. The referee didn't expect that. Yeah, black fighter's coming in close. Nice right again there, that was good. I think this blue fighter, yeah, he's got an uppercut there and a nice right hand over the top. That's got to have hurt. That was a good shot. He's turned away, but oh, well, he's spat the tooth out. He's carrying on. That takes some bottle of power. You get punched in the teeth, you don't want to carry on. These guys have got some courage to carry on after an injury like that, the fact that he's losing bodily parts. That was cheeky again. Caught him in the clinch. Every time we go into the clinch, he's catching him with a punch. And the black fighter waved a finger at him. He wasn't happy about it. He's obviously still thinking about his tooth. The blue fighter is dominating now. Oh, yeah, there he goes. Bandage is coming undone, and he's caught him while he's doing his bandage. What happens if your bandage is coming undone? He's probably looking for a bit of a rest. Keep showing the referee the bandage, and every time he touches his bandage, the black fighter takes advantage and hits him. He's pushing him over there in the throat there. And I'm not sure I'm happy about that. The second's coming in. The second's getting a bit involved now because I think he sees his man's getting a bit tired. These have become wrestlers now. They're really tired. Oh, it's over. He's conceded. I think that's just out of pure exhaustion more than anything else. The crowd seems pretty happy about it. It's obviously their man. Oh, the guy's got a shirt off in the crowd. There's a lot of would-bes there. What they don't realise is it's one thing fighting in the crowd, it's another thing fighting in the arena. This is what I like to see. These two guys who have been fighting in the crowd have decided to come out and settle their differences with a straightener. Oh, the blue fighter's been knocked down. That was a good shot, but he's got straight back up again. Plenty of cujo, back into the fight again. The blue fighter is trying to close the distance, but he's really got no artillery. He's got wild hands, he's not really using a lot of body weight. These don't really know what they're doing, they're just having a scrap. Oh, he's caught a good shot there, he's knocked him right the way back. That was a good shot. The only thing you can say about these guys is that this is the way to settle it, rather than have a grudge and hate each other the rest of your life, just settle it like men.
Bare-fist fighting was perceived as the ultimate mark of Britishness, as opposed to the sort of rather effete, dandified Frenchman across the Channel. The Englishman was always, in their view, worth five Frenchmen, because he could box. The legal attitude was somewhat ambivalent. Although bare-knuckle fighting had actually been illegal since Jack Broughton lost the Duke of Cumberland's money in 1750, it was said that one-third of the House of Commons and the House of Lords were at one time taking lessons from John Jackson in his rooms in Bond Street. During the 1820s, the popularity of prize fighting reached its absolute zenith, and one of the writers of the time christened it the Age of Boxermania. It was the sport for all young men, public school young men, dustmen, all strata of society had to know about boxing, but it was never really respectable.
Boxing may not have been respectable, but the bare-knuckle fighters were men of respect. Bare-fist champs like Kilrain, Sullivan, Goss were international sports stars. They were savage, but there was ritual, all that violence time with an edge. Bare-fist law ran boxing for 150 years until the Marquess of Queensbury wrote his glove rules in 1867. Before then, it all started when the referees scratched their mark inside a 24-foot ring staked out with posts and ropes. Two big fighters would step inside. Now this corner stuff, they'd start toe-to-toe, face-to-face, with knuckle up. The timekeeper was called time. The fighters lined up fists, ready to hurt each other. The bell sounds. Let the fight begin. Bare-fist rules allowed hip throws. When a man hit the ground, the round ended. Fighters sat on the knee of their seconds and had half a minute's rest between rounds. Fights could last 6 hours. The big men always went back toe-to-toe after the bell. In 1827, New London rules cut out hip throws. The champions toughened their knuckles in whiskey and turpentine to make fists like hammers. After the new boxing rules stressed punching over wrestling, men circled the boxers with whips to keep the crowd at bay. It was mean and bloody, but bare knuckles was the sport of proper men.
Bare fist fighting, in my time, we was frowned upon as bad guys. In King George IV's time, they was held as legends. They even went to his coronation as his friends
and minders.
Well, towards the beginning of the 18th century, when boxing became popular, King George I had a ring set up here in Hyde Park so that any belligerent chairman or coachman or indeed anybody could come here to settle their disputes rather than blocking up the streets of the capital. The culture of bare fist boxing began to overtake the culture of
the use of weapons, which was still going strong on the continent. People were being killed, dueling with swords or pistols. In England, it became the fashion to settle your disputes with bare fists. Brutal, but not deadly.
Probably 100 years ago, street fighting wasn't just about street fighting. It was about sex. Death Burke, the English champion, he would travel America posing as a Greek statue, half naked. Sex and violence, it would encourage the women to come and see the shows. Isn't it funny how sex and violence always get banned?
Our next match, we've got a green fighter and a blue fighter. The taller blue fighter looks to me to have the advantage to start. He's throwing a lot of straight punches. He's using his height to keep the green fighter off. Doesn't seem to be a lot of weight behind the punches. He's not really committing his body weight. That might be just because he's just feeling the guy out at the moment. The older fighter looks like he's got a nice left hand. He's unusual. He's actually leading with his right hand. Taller fighter took a shot there and backed away. That's not a good time to start. The blue fighter now is backing away an awful lot. And when he's throwing the punches, his footwork goes to pot. See, he's throwing big flurries, but probably only one of five or six is landing, so he's expending a lot of energy for nothing. Oh, what a shot. That was a really good shot. Oh, the crowd ain't happy about that because he's gone for the kill. See, they're all getting to their feet. That punch stopped him in his tracks. That was a really good shot. He looks like he's getting a little bit mardy about it as well. He's playing with his bandages. He's caught him while he's taking his bandages off. He's that unhappy about it. He's tried to kick him. Okay, he's put his hands up and kind of, in a way, he's saying sorry and he's going in now. He knows the blue fighter's out of there now. Yes, another good left hand. He's found an opening. He's found a window there and he's putting that left hand in again and again. It looks like it's over. Is it over? Yeah, the blue fighter's had enough. He doesn't want to go. Oh, we spat at him. What's that all about? That was a little bit disrespectful. The crowd are not happy about that. Are they going to shake hands? Yeah, they're shaking hands, that's better. See, there's a lot of honour here. They've got to shake hands. There's got to be that shake hand at the end to say that there's no animosity and it's over.
This is the great Gerald Sullivan on the right. He was really the first of them great glove champions, but he was also the last of the bare-knuckle champions. He fought three major bare-knuckle fights, the last of which was in 1889 for the World Championship. After the fight, both fighters were imprisoned for short periods and fined heavily. After that, he more or less renounced the bare knuckles to concentrate on glove fighting. He was really the first great knockout artist in boxing. Bare knuckle fighting really died in 1889. The sport was trying to get acceptance, and glove fighting could be held in indoor arenas and all the members of the public could watch it. Bare knuckle fighting was driven to really a hole in the corner kind of position.
But bare-knuckle fighting wouldn't die. A whole nation of people, Europe's gypsies and the travellers, was keeping bare-knuckle alive in secret, fighting for honour and for money.
There is a condition when two men want to get in a ring and fight. It is between them two men. But isn't me and Lovers using it in the fighting, this bare-knuckle fight? Police came to my house, they arrested me. They was looking for bare-knuckle tickets, and they was arresting me for inciting to organise a bare-knuckle fight. I think the last person who was done for it was in 17-something, like, I think it was. They charged me to arrange or be part of a bare-knuckle fight, which I was found not guilty of. With bare-knuckle, you pick the time. It's more like a chess game. You wait, watch the opponent. You aim for the ribs, the kidney punch, jaw, facial areas. I mean, if you cut a man's eyes, he can't see it, then he can't fight. A man's weakness, it might be his body. He might be weak to jabs to the face. What you do when you get in there, you get it over and done with as quickly as possible. Naturally, you don't want to give the man any more pain than what it's possibly got to do for him. If the man says, well, I've had enough, then the man's had enough. In bare knuckle fighting, it's one man against one bone. As what Travers used to say, is one dog, one bone.
Yeah, I see barefist boxing as the basis of our culture. It's the absolute basis, really, because we have to fight for our money, we have to fight for somewhere to live. So it is, fighting is our culture. Gypsy Boxing Association is to make sure the gypsy boys get a fair crack of the whip. It's to instill the pride in the gypsy man.
It makes you feel good that you've won. And like, not only that, you've won and you finish up shaking hands at the finish.
Don't do it here.
Boxing gloves. It's stupid. It's a stupid thing to do. All they're doing is making the man last longer. The gloves are there to protect the hand, not to protect the opponent. They're just there so that people can stand there and watch people fight for longer periods of time and take more punishment. There's no need for that. It could be decided in 2, 3, 4 rounds, whatever. You don't have to stand there for 16 rounds bashing each other to death just because your hands are not hurting. That's not fighting. You know, I mean, fight's a fight, and it's bare fist all the way.
This man is the challenger. He wants to settle his dispute in a 500-year-old gypsy tradition. We're in the town square. They've shut the pubs, told the police to piss off, and the entire place is closed down for a bare-knuckle fight.
What's your name? Henry McGinley.
Where do you come from?
From Northern. Yeah.
You're proposing to fight
Sam Ronan.
Sam Ronan. Sam was born and reared here in this place.
I try and came to bear a mini for him. Is that Morgan? How much is that?
What time is the fight scheduled to start?
Anytime, whenever he wants to fight an hour. Anytime he shoots me, he shoots him. If it's here, he can't see the top.
The tension is running high. The avid fighter, Dan Rooney, is late for the fight.
I saw her at this lab. Did you see her?
The bare knuckle fight is nothing like a street brawl. There is a referee to make sure both fighters get a fair go.
If it's a clean fight, all you have to do is break every time you hit him.
That's right.
No holding,
no pushing, or no messing. The big guy, Dan Rooney, finally arrived. He's flown all the way from London, and he doesn't look worried. The two fighters and their managers meet in the middle of the ring. They shake hands like proper sporting men. Then it's shirt off, step up to the line, knuckles ready for boxing, like it's been for 6,000 years. Don't try this at home, kids. The gypsy boys are going to show you how they fight. Keep your elbows up, keep the old chin up, that's it. Instead of staying off this big guy, he should come in now, come up and swing round, and then as he goes back, go to work. Nah, you know, and bring his hands up, uppercuts. Do a Tyson on this big guy. The little fella should crouch. Go underneath him, come up with them shots. I'll give them credit, they're having a fight, but, you know, they could make a better job of it if they stand toe-to-toe and stop running around the track like Sebastian Coe. Stop poking your tongue out, you silly prat. Get in here and have a fight. personally, I've knocked the two of them out, one after another. But, you know, I'm here to commentate, not to slag them off. The crowd are happy. I think someone just won bingo. Not a bad fight, I suppose. You know, he's got a cut eye, and now he gives a bit of indigestion.
The two men, but McGinley and Rooney, claim as victory. Claim as victory. I don't know which of them is claiming, both of them is claiming victory. McGinley claims he'll fight him for £100,000 in Ballinasloe Green and the October Fair. If he sits to take a challenge, it's time to take it.
Why
did
he not take it today?
While authorities have been out to get bare-knuckle fighters this century,
dead or alive,
Hollywood was making them into heroes.
Superman,
the greatest hero of them all, is a cracking bare-knuckle fighter. He might wear his drawers on the outside, but you'll never catch the Man of Steel wearing gloves for a fight. Hollywood movies had to have heroes fight bare fists to make the tough guy pay. Movie heroes use bare fists to sort out space monsters and spooks, gangsters and bad guys. And men whose hats don't fall off. Even Hollywood policemen crack heads bare fists when in real life they'll nick ya.
I can fix that too.
A proper hero don't use a weapon or a blade. He uses bare knuckles to sort out trouble. Hollywood made bare fist fighters into heroes, but China made them into priests. Monks from Shaolin invented a tough-handed technique called Kung Fu that's followed like a religion all over China. In Thailand last century, the fighters took up a French kick and punch bare fist technique. Today, Thai boxing with no gloves goes on. In Brazil, they settled their differences with a bare fist style called Vau Chuda. It's a bit like the English old bare knuckle rules, where you are allowed to wrestle a man over. But down South America, they can wrestle and punch kick all they like, and it ain't against the law. Watch these lads go for it. Go, my son. Go, boy. That's it. Bang. Left hook. Shoot. Yeah. Bang. Oops. The big trouble around the world is not men trading fists. It's men using arms.
The enemy of today is becoming more gratuitous and it has become more weapon orientated. Bare fist is not the enemy. The weapon culture is the enemy now. And basically a lot of people carry weapons because they can't use the fists. And they perhaps can't use the fists because this kind of thing is frowned upon.
This is real violence. See this. I've seen men stabbed, killed, cut and maimed with this. I see a guy stabbed with something like this 10 years ago, and he's walking along with a big scar down his face. And the guy who done it doesn't even remember why he done it. I've got no time for people using it, because basically they're cowards. This is filth.
Okay, we've got a grey fighter and a black fighter in this match. The black fighter is the taller guy, standing back with his guard down. He looks like he's the Sugar Ray Leonard of the bare knuckle scene. He's dancing around and he's calling the guy on. He's bringing him up. It's more of an intimidating factor. You notice as soon as the grey fighter comes in, his guard comes straight the way back up. The grey fighter looks like he's just trying to wait and tire the guy out. And he's also getting a feel for what kind of artillery he's got. We've got a classic fight here of a counter-puncher against an attacking puncher. Well, that was the right hand then. That was a good one. The older guy, see his defense, see his counters, is really very sharp. That's another right hand again. He's waiting to be attacked, sometimes even taking a shot to give two back, which isn't always a good thing, but he's parrying a lot of them away. He's a very good defensive fighter. Nice jab again. That was a heavy shot. Oh, that was a good left hook. Oh, he's pulling his trousers up. In a way, what he's saying there, this is easy. I'm going to pull my trousers up. I'm going to get my towels ready. You're not intimidating me. And the way he's just hopping around, he looks very confident. The black fighter is missing with more punches than he's hitting now. But that has a bad mental effect on you when you're fighting. It starts the inner turmoil. You know, that was a nice right. The taller fighter's got a high guard. He could do with the grey fighter could do with hitting the body to bring the guard down. Oh, that was a good one. I think he's broke his nose. Yeah, the referee stopped it. He caught him. Yeah, his nose is broke.
This is called a cistus. 2,000 years ago, Greeks used to fight like this. Sometimes they would use lead in the knuckle area, and they would do a lot of damage. But not as much damage as this. Because this you can only hit a certain time before you bust your hand. You can hit someone all day long with this.
Grab some bare fists. Here's a science demonstration using the actual brain of a mate of mine. In a fight, the brain bounces in your head in watery stuff called cerebral fluid. In a bare fist fight, a head punch makes the brain shake. But you can only hit a man a certain time before you break your hand. Knuckles break before a brain gets busted. A glove is different. You can hit a man harder. In Queensbury rules, short fights with a 3-minute rounds force boxers to go for knockout head punches. Gloves save knuckles, but battered the brain. After years of it, your brain is a bloody mess. This brain is of the first fighter named as Punchdrunk, a featherweight whose hands wouldn't stop trembling. A generation after Queensbury rules, a doctor spotted this new sickness. New rules led to Punchdrunk syndrome. The spilt blood of boxers always been a sign of honor and a mark of courage. But the gloves that ended bare knuckle era had battered a trail of unnecessary slaughter. Forcing gloves onto fighters has been one of the biggest sports disasters in the world. Last century, only a few dozen bare-knuckle fighters died. In 60 years of Queensbury rules, more than 600 boxers have been killed in the US and Britain. Thousands more have had their brains wrecked by punch-drunk syndrome, never heard of before Queensbury started glove fighting. To all the dead fighters, I salute you. To the Marcus of Queensbury, you would turn in your grave if you knew what you'd done with your murderous gloves. What happened to bare-knuckle boxers 100 years ago is now happening to glove fighting today. Doctors who have seen boxers get hurt think it's time to ban the old sport.
In the early 1980s, a number of doctors have been observing the numbers of cases there have been of people dying or being seriously injured in the ring. Medicine was suddenly able to see what was happening to the brain in people while they're still alive. Could see the deterioration using imaging techniques, and that means that it became much more immediately apparent that people were being damaged. Well, gloves protect the hand to a great extent of the person who is hitting. That's one of their advantages. Their disadvantages, you still get the rotation forces applied to the brain. The brain has almost no capacity to heal, and even if people stop being hit on the head, stop boxing, they will continue to deteriorate in most cases. The punch-drunk syndrome is the end stage. It's the end stage of chronic brain damage from boxing. It's something that was first observed early in this century from people who've been boxers for very many years. And you saw effectively a form of Parkinson's disease with the difficulty in balance and coordination and some dementia and slurred speech and so on. Many people become involved in boxing and may drift from regulated to unregulated boxing in the hope of making more of a living there. Well, clearly bare-knuckle boxing exposes you to other dangers, but it's very important to say that there is still the issue of brain damage. You're taking all the risks of conventional glove boxing. You're taking the additional risks of a lot of injuries to bone and to soft tissue. Classically, you'll see damage to the knuckles and to the small bones of the hand with fractures, dislocations, chronic repeated injuries because of impact on joints, which are not meant to take a lot of force a lot of times. You're probably taking an increased risk of eye injury, and you're taking the additional risk of potential bloodborne diseases.
Well, I first started bare-knuckle fighting. Teenagers just left school, and to hear on a Sunday afternoon these cries, and they were beckoning for blood. They want to see blood, and all they wanted was blood and gore and bone, and sinews flying. This went on for a number of years, and I ended up. It was my wife that eventually stopped me. I come home one day, and even my children didn't recognise me. The eyes were red slits, my mouth, my lips, I could hardly speak, my nose, was nearly bit off, scars there, the guy nearly bit my nose off. She pleaded with me time and time again to stop this bare knuckles. I always looked up to men that could fight. They were my heroes, guys that could knock hell out of each other. There are other things more important in life than this so-called sport.
The next match, we've got a black fighter and a blue fighter.
They must be swapping trainers.
Both of these guys look like they've been in this arena many, many times. Both evenly matched. I think you can see a bit more professionalism here as well. The blue fighter is constantly moving his guard around. That's making his face a very hard target. It's also kind of throwing little feints. It makes it hard for the black fighter to see when he's going to throw a punch. The blue fighter's got a really nice jab, a very sharp jab, and a good high guard. He took one on the face there, though. Back into a clinch again. He's clinching pretty early. The referee's controlling them. The black fighter hasn't done anything yet, really. Oh, that was a good right on the jaw. I've got a feeling that this black fighter's going to come out of the closet. He's letting the blue fighter tire himself out. You notice the black fighter is moving constantly to the blue fighter's left. That's because he's trying to avoid the right hand. Oh, that was a good right on the jaw. See, the black fighter's coming into it a bit more now. A bit more confident. He's using open hand. He's using that so he can parry. Oh, that's a nice shot. The dark fighter has actually drawn blood now over the light fighter's left eye. This black fighter, he doesn't need to be frightened of that right hand because there's nothing in it, it's empty. So you notice now he's stopped moving around to the right so much. The blue fighter is getting a little bit wild with his punches, and although they might connect, they're not going to do much damage. And he got him on the clinch there, that was a bit naughty. The referee's warning him. Nice little parry there. Black fighter parried that jab really well, and that was a good counter punch there. A good counter with his lead jab. He's ducking underneath his punches really, really well. This blue fighter is going to be exhausted very soon because, as you can see, there's no breaks for rounds here. And he's picked up a bad cut on the right eye. You cut really easy with bare knuckle. What he's doing now is he's looking at that eye. See, the black fighter's coming into it a bit more now. He's looking at this eye, and he's just going to keep hitting it. All he's aiming for is that eye. Every time he hits that eye, he's going to take the fight out of this guy, and in the end, he's just not going to want to fight. What's happening as well is because he's got a bad cut to the eye, the body will be releasing in-fight adrenaline. And the in-fight adrenaline, although it's going to act as an anesthetic, it's going to tire him really quickly. It's a turbo drive that will eat up all his fuel. The fight now for the blue fighter is on the inside. He's fighting with himself. But look at that right. He's just wasting his time. And the black fighter is having a tea break and ducking underneath it. A nice right again. Oh, it's over. He's conceded. And the black fighter's got it. But the blue fighter is really mardy. This black fighter, I wouldn't turn my back on him. He is really mad that he's lost the fight. He's mad because he's bottled it at the end. And I can understand why he's bottled it.
Come out of the Marines in 86. And I was doing some personal protection on various unscrupulous people. And basically I was offered some cash to fight someone. And they was talking large amounts of cash to me at the time, like, you know, 3K for your first fight. It's kind of cool. Thought I was pretty tasty, pretty hard. So away we went, basically. Somebody else came along and offered me a better fight with better money. Well, that was sort of like in a boat, in the Bristol Channel, in the bottom of a boat. And the rules for that were a bit changed because whoever promoted it, obviously, sent too many karate movers or whatever. And there's guys there who tied, you know, tie bandages around your fists, and basically on this like bit of a table, you know, you got a tub of glue and a tub of glass and a tub of some grit, and basically anything that small shot was going to stick some glue on some bandages, so you dunk your hands in them a bit, and that was it. It's a bit of a shock, to be honest. The punter's paying for it, obviously got a better blood factor for the money. I didn't really expect that kind of aggravation, you know what I mean? It's like, you know, I don't mind going a few rounds with somebody with bare knuckles, like when you start sticking shit on your hands, you know, you might as well be drawing blades. And I'm not into that. So I've seen the first fight in Britain to the death. They're paying big money to watch this thing. You know, the tickets are going for £500 a go, man. It was a long fight, you know. It's like when you know if you're going to go down, basically you're going to be killed if you go down. £25,000 for the winner. There's a hell of a lot more for whoever was promoting it. They classed it as a battle of the colours, because one dude was black and one dude was white. You know, and it's like, this fight is to the death. One guy's neck got broken and he'd been taking a lot of head punches and a lot of body blows and a few to the kidneys, and basically the guy just went in and gave him a few to the ribs, just grabbed hold of his neck and just threw him over his back and just held on to his neck instead of releasing it, and busted the bloody neck. Bare knuckle boxing, you start commercialising it and legalising it, and kids off the street think they're going to be able to do it, and basically they're just going to meet the most horrible people on the planet. And I don't mean the guys fighting them, the promoters are eating for breakfast, and once they've had their fun out of them, they'll stick them in the room, and some old guy's going to kill them, you know? Just going to kill them.
Personally, I hate violence. I'm not a violent man. I was brought up in violence. So to survive, I had to go that route. I've come a long way since growing up here in London's East End. These streets led me to where barefist fighters survive today. Among the gamblers, the bouncers, and the gypsies. We've been doing it for hundreds of years. I must have had 15,000 fights, and all I learned is this. It's a tradition, but not a solution. What I know now is violence is no smart guy solution. Choose violence, and you're just going to get more violence back. There is the violent road, and there's the easy road. Take the easy road. It's full of happiness. Follow me. Thank you.